Okay, everyone. Hi, thank you for coming. So it's a real pleasure today to introduce Adrian Saurin. Adrian did his PhD at King's College and then a postdoc with Peter Parker working on PKC signaling, where he took kind of an unexpected turn into mitosis and did some really nice work on that project, and then followed that interest onto another postdoc in Utrecht with Geert Kops. He now runs his own lab at the University of Dundee, funded by CRUK, and he's going to talk to us about his work today.
Thanks, Jo. Thanks for this invite, and thanks for everyone turning up. Hopefully I can, I'm going to talk to you about the interest of my lab, protein phosphorylation, cell cycle, anti-cancer treatments, and I'm going to go into some specifics, but I'm going to try and keep it really minimal, actually, and the things that I want to kind of convey today are very general messages, so you don't work in the kind of things that I do. That shouldn't really matter. Okay, so let's start by protein phosphorylation. They're going to be two halves, actually. The first half's going to be about mainly about protein phosphorylation. Of course, we know a huge amount about protein phosphorylation. Hundreds of thousands of sites, different tissues, disease states, different organisms, you know, because we're in a world of big data. And that tells us a lot, clearly. And we're now getting to the point where we can do single cell proteomics. So that's going to get even more complex, just as transcriptomics and genomics have. And the purpose of this first slide is really to make a point that whilst this information will undoubtedly advance science in many ways and already has and will continue to, I think there's also a potentially a risk that because we have all this data, we don't have the sort of whether the need, the inclination to just sit and think about very simple things anymore. So to do what Newton did and stir apples. Because you know, then right, we have no choice, we scientists have no choice than to think about problems more because data is scarce. And with all this data, you know, questions aren't really a problem anymore because you know the data itself gives more questions than it answers, right? So we're kind of pulled away from these simple things. And what I wanted to do in the first half today is give an opportunity to pull us back and think about protein phosphorylation and this question, which is something that's really occupied my lab since I started about 10 years ago. How do binary signals produce complex outputs? Okay, so let's start with this basic description. Everyone will be very familiar with this. Antagonistic regulation by kinase and phosphatase is turning substrates on and off by phosphorylation. So you can think about that like a light, nice binary switch light response. But signal responses are often more complex than binary. And the first thing to note there is that complexity arises because individual molecules don't control the whole response. However many thousands or sometimes hundreds of thousands of copies of that molecule determines a response. And so how those copies behave in time and space is the key thing. And if we think about it like that, then actually kinases and phosphatases are working cooperatively to shape those many copies of that molecule. So there's a very big distinction here. They're working antagonistically on each one, but they're shaping how the copies behave over time and space. And so you can think about that instead of being like a library for that one substrate, you think of it being like a monitor. It can have very different types. You can have thousands of lights which give different responses, such as amplitude, localization. And we've been particularly interested in this understanding this cooperativity, because I think that generally labs tend to sit in a kinase or a phosphatase and have that as a core interest. But I think the understanding the cooperativity between the two, I would argue, really is very crucial. And this is a review article I wrote a few years ago. I think mitosis is a great system to look at this, mainly because the phosphatase inputs are very well defined. Obviously, we need to understand those to be able to understand how they work together, these enzymes. So read this if you're interested. That's occupied my lab for probably the first 8 years. But just during the last 2 years, we became really aware of cooperativity on single molecule on this level on the left. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. Pretty much everything I'll talk to you today is unpublished. It's on bioarchive, so you can read more about it. And so what do I mean by this cooperativity on the left? Well, it's particular kinase phosphatase pairs, PLK or CDK1 being the kinase, and PB2A56 being the phosphatase. So what's special about those? Well, firstly, the phosphatase, it's a promiscuous phosphatase. It doesn't really care too much. Well, serine threonine but the surrounding sequence doesn't carry too much. So how does it have specificity? It has specificity by binding to short linear motifs, softening unstructured regions of proteins. So refer to them as SLIMs. So that brings the phosphatase to a substrate. The other key thing is that phosphorylation seems to be a crucial regulator of those interactions. So phosphorylation drives the interaction. And that the phosphate are within sequence, which I'll come on to, sequence motifs that are liked by PLK and CDK1, right? So those kinases on the left often recruit PP2A, BFT6 to substrates. So now let's think about the kinase. They're phosphorylating these substrates or associated proteins on many phosphorylation sites, one of which recruits a phosphatase, which starts dephosphorylating them. So think about that. And the prediction is that what those kinases do on these substrates is this kind of thing, turning the substrate on and then driving the off reaction at the same time. So they're dynamic, flashing. And there can be many reasons for these kind of dynamics. And we talk about this in a commentary just a few years ago as well. So you can read more about this. I'll mention one or two. So robustness is, I think, a reasonably simple concept to grasp. Normally, if you turn off a kinase, the phosphorylation of its substrates will drop and disappear. In this kind of situation, the prediction is you turn off, if you inhibit the kinase, you decrease the on rate, but you also decrease the off rate as well. So that steady state levels might not change as dramatically, but what would predict it to change is the level of, you know, the dynamics, the on-off rate. Okay, it's a prediction. I'll come on to this about we can't measure these. So some other ideas, a rapid proline binding release cycle. This is just an idea. There's not really any sort of evidence for this in the literature. We're working on it in the lab. It's an interesting one to think about, which is an idea that if phosphorylation drives binding of substrates, that's typically associated with slow release, right? Strong binding, slow release. Now, if you want to have things within signaling complexes which have fast binding and fast release, you could potentially use this kind of thing where phosphorylation drives binding and then a phosphatase drives the release. So this is kind of an interesting thing, one to think about, and really fundamental questions that we're trying to get to in the lab. But what I want to point out is the issue that we have in understanding these dynamics is we can't measure them. Okay, so what I mean by that is just let's think about an individual molecule. And it's 50% of the molecule, it's the same substrate, 50% can be on, as in phosphorylated, and 50% can be off. Okay, or they could be flashing on and off 100% of the molecules, either very fast or very slow. As long as they're spending the same time in the on and the off state, then all those three situations, when you measure them, fix the situation, and you do Western blot, you know, fluorescence, quantitative mass spectrometry, you get stoichiometers back, but you'll lose the dynamics. So you get 50% stoichiometers in all three cases, right? So by doing the assays, you've lost the dynamic information. So essentially don't apply to this. And I think this is a huge thing from a signaling context to think about. And so we're fortunate, we've got an assay to measure this. We think we've got an assay to measure this. It's very early stages. I'm not going to present any of the data. We've got funding by the Wellcome Trust. Really kind of grateful for that. And hopefully in a year or two, we'll be able to kind of put a number on these dynamics. But what I want to do is tell you the work that led up to this. I was thinking about it, and then paint a bigger picture here about why these are important in signaling. Okay, so here we'll have to give you a little bit of detail. I'll try and keep it to the minimum. Okay, so we work on this protein called BUBBA1, which binds to these kinase pair, phosphatase pair that I mentioned, PLK and PP2A. And you'll see there that the PP2A binding motif, this is the SLIM that I mentioned. The phosphorylation, often in these plus two positions here after the motif, that will drive the interaction. And PLK likes phosphorylating things that are two residues down of acidic residues. So that's why PLK likes the phosphorylated motifs. Okay, so in this context here in BUBBA1, PLK does recruit PP2A. And so what does this protein do? Where is it? Well, it's at a kinetochore, which in mitosis is basically a giant complex which will attach to microtubules on the duplicated chromosomes. So all you need to know for this talk is the two processes which the kinetochore controls, which are central. One of which is a checkpoint, which I'll refer to as the spindle assembly checkpoint, or SAC. And that checkpoint will keep that cell in mitosis whilst those kinetochores are not attached to microtubules. And that's important, of course, because they're not ready to leave mitosis. So that's all you really need to know about this checkpoint. The other thing is that the PLK1 is an important kinase in activating that checkpoint. Okay, that's the only other bit of information. Now, the other process you need to know is the fact that microtubules attach to these kinetic cores, the landing pads essentially. The microtubules combine and then pull these chromosomes apart. And that process of attacking the microtubule is regulated as well. And one of the key regulators is PP2A. And PP2A strengthens those microtubule attachments. And it works, it's thought to work, just because phosphate electrostatically interferes with the microtubule binding. So PP2A takes that phosphate off and stabilizes the microtubule. Okay, so that's been published before. It's a little bit more complex because there's crosstalk. So POK stabilizes microtubules, and that's assumed, although never shown, to be because it recruits the PP2A, which stabilizes microtubules. It makes a lot of sense. The other thing is PP2A silences the checkpoint. Our group and Ulrika Grunberg's group, quite a number of years ago, our first paper in the lab actually, showed that this phosphatase silences the sac, and we assumed at the time that it just dephosphorylates key sac substrates. You know, there can be many of these. But what we actually showed a couple of years ago is that this is the key thing that it gets rid of, and probably the only phosphate. So this removes this kinase, which is important for the sac. Okay. So there's a little bit of complexity there. I think that's most of it. So it's really interesting for us because you've got these two key processes during mitosis that are essential for genome stability. They're regulated by a kinase phosphatase pair at the same location of a protein. And the other thing to us was that when we did evolutionary analysis, it was clear to us that these binding domains almost always evolved. They look like they're co-evolved together because they're almost always present in the same region of BOBO1. So you can see here, this green box signifies PP2A binding, the red PLK binding. And here you can see the relative positions, and you can see that they're in the same unstructured region, and usually within about 50 of 100 amino acid region. Okay, so this tells us that this is probably functionally very important. Okay, so what I'm going to tell you is just a really trimmed down version of this paper on bioarchive. Two great postdocs in the lab, Marilia started this, Andrea picked it up, Marilia left the lab, Andrea picked this up. And it's been going for a number of years in the lab, and I'm just going to present maybe three or four slides. Okay, so the first thing is this is a homeostatic negative feedback. You can see that. So the kinase is recruiting a phosphatase that actually removes the kinase. And the phosphatase is removing the kinase, which is recruiting the phosphatase. So essentially, you can't go to. So the more kinase activity you have, the more you remove yourself. Okay. And vice versa. So this, what I mean by homeostatic is you get a kind of a certain level of PLK activity here, but if you remove the phosphatase, which is what we've done here in this situation, PLK jumps up, and this phosphocyte jumps up as well. And if we fuse the phosphatase there, so it doesn't rely on this phosphorylation, then this is gone and PLK is gone, right? And then we're down here, but we're usually in the middle. And so I'm going to refer to these as kinase dominant, phosphatase dominant situations. We lock this to either just have the PLK or just have the PP2A attention. And we look at the phenotypes of those two. One thing to point out, I'm not showing you all the data, there's a figure on this, and this loop is intramolecular. There's hundreds of these clustered around a very small region in the kinetic cord. So in theory, they could be crosstalking between BOBO1 molecules, but they're not. And that probably tells you why this region is within 50 amino acids of each other. This is an intramolecular feedback loop. Okay, so you don't really need to know the purpose of the assay. What you need to know about this graph is this is a checkpoint strength. We're looking at this sac checkpoint, and we do it in the conditions where we can see things get stronger or weaker. And if you go down this graph from the wild type, the sac gets stronger, and conversely, it gets weaker if you move up. And what you can see is that if we lock the kinase dominant situation, the sac gets stronger, and if we lock the phosphatase, it gets weaker. That's what we would predict because the kinase is the thing activating the site. If we do an assay that instead measures the microtubule attachment strength, we get the opposite picture. So in this case, if we've got the phosphatase just there, you move down this graph, which is stronger stability of microtubules compared to the wild type situation. Yeah. Whereas on the right, if we lock the kinase, you've now got weaker microtubules. Microtubules can't form because they've not got the phosphatase there and they've just got the kinase. So the key thing about this is a balance between two enzymes driving two processes. And if you tip it to one, that one process works very well, but the other one works weak. And conversely, if you go the other way, what does it look like? Well, you'd probably be more familiar with just looking at an image of a cell dividing. Here's the typical cell divider aligned with chromosomes and next to mitosis. If you're skewed towards the kinase, what happens is the cell will get into mitosis. It will never be able to attach a microtubule properly, and they have a strong checkpoint that will stay there. It will be a mess. The chromosomes won't align. And if you look the other way, you get exactly the opposite. The cell gets in and flies out of mitosis before it's had a chance to properly attach microtubule because they're so stable and the checkpoint is so weak that it just dries out. Okay, so cells use this to get this middle ground, and if you interfere with it, you go, the process goes wrong in both directions. Another question to Azir was that, okay, the balance is crucial between these two enzymes, but how does a kinetic course set the right level of activity of either the kinase or the phosphatase, right? Presumably you'll need a certain amount of activity of each of them to drive these processes. Why the balance between the two is important, clearly, but the level of activity should be, and how does it set that? So this is the last bit of extra information I have to give you. And that's that the BOBO1 protein itself binds to SLINT, short linear motifs, that are called MELTs for an amino acid sequence, essentially. And the T is the thing that's phosphorylated here to bind to BOBO1. So KNO1, this is what I said earlier, KNO1 is this, it's a giant protein, a couple of thousand amino acids, and it's got many of these MELT motifs, and they've degenerated some of them, so they don't all work to the same strength. But on average, there's 6 bub complexes bound to each molecule, and there's 150 molecules on a kinetic course. You're getting to kind of, you know, this is a clustering that I'm saying. You've got thousands of these big unstructured domains which are scaffolding this key enzyme. So what we wanted to do, we didn't want to interfere with the feedback now between the two, or the balance between the two. We wanted to just change the levels up and down to what they should be. So what we did is we mutated, it was kind of a mammoth cloning effort at the time. It's a difficult protein to work with. We got rid of all these the key binding regions on those SLINTs, so we shouldn't have any binding. And then we started putting back like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up to potentially 19 really good ones. So you can go down to less or more than there normally is. And you get this kind of response for the protein itself, BOBO1, which is really nice. You can see that if you've got rid of the melts, you've completely lost the protein from kinetic course. And you start putting them back up and you get to a kind of normal amount, and then you get more if you go up to 19. And the enzymes, PLK and PP2A, follow the same pattern. So here now we're not changing the balance, we're just changing the actual amounts of each two, and they're moving together. So you can either have too little enzyme or too much enzyme, and we can make predictions. What should happen here is when you've got too little enzyme, you've got a weak checkpoint and weak microtubule attachments, and conversely, they're too strong when they're too much. And that's essentially what we saw. I'll show you two snippets of results, but here's checkpoint strength again. You can see that compared to a wild type, which sits in the middle, you get weaker as you're red here, or you've got less melt motifs, and you get stronger when you're down at the bottom and you've got too many. And this strength is due to the kinase, because we can inhibit that PLK1. And now these are no longer strong, and they're kind of the same. Okay, hopefully that was clear. There's a similar picture with microtubule attachment. We don't need to go into the details here, but too many, the microtubules are stable, and no melts, and they're really unstable again. So this is the conclusion. This is what I wanted to sort of focus on. If you didn't follow some of that detail, you have this balance of enzymes, which can either lead to, if it's skewed, out of balance, the processes don't work. But in a normal situation, there's a key feedback which keeps the right levels. And these melt motifs set the right levels for the enzyme, which are rapidly evolving themselves within this protein KNO1, to make things work as they should do. Okay. So everything seems to be about balance. And I think that this is the way that we talk about this paper on bioarchive, and it all makes sense. But I feel that there's much more to it. And I think that a kind of analogy that I like to think here is that we're, I feel like we're prisoners in this cave of Plato. If anyone's like kind of familiar with this allegory of the cave from Plato, which is quite simple, it's just, you know, you're prisoners which were born and chained to a wall here in a cave, right? They didn't see anything else apart from this cave and these shadows which move along the wall, right? That's all they ever saw. So this is about the nature of belief versus knowledge or the power of education, right? So obviously they make opinions of what those shadows are, right? Life forms, whatever, which is very real to them. But if they were to move back here and have another perspective, given another perspective and see the reality, they'd have a completely different view of it, right? So they're making opinions based on what they can see. And I think that on the right here, what we're doing is similar. And I would argue, going back to the dynamics, if we could see dynamics, probably this is the situation where you either have got kinase on, phosphatase on, in between. And so what could these kind of flashing things do? This is what we're trying to get at in the lab now. And I can talk about this later, but this is specific to this process here. But I want to just take a step even further back. I'm not talking here about the importance of proteins cycling on and off, phosphate cycling on and off proteins, and what that can do for that protein. I'm talking about something much bigger. And what I want to try and illustrate at that point is to go back to this and think, okay, instead of, we can do what I said at the start here, instead of stirring apples, though, let's just kind of stir at that cell and think about, I'm going to give you a thought experiment, and kind of all think together, I guess, about if we can measure proteomics in a single cell is doable now. Phosphoproteomics isn't, but probably will be. And so let's just assume we can measure phosphoproteomics on that single cell. We might get 100,000 phosphorylation sites thereabout, and they'll all have a certain stoichiometry between 0 and 100. Okay? Now let's just assume that cell is in quiescence, it's not changing its cell cycle state, it's an incubator, it's got everything it needs, it's got nutrients, it's just alive. We're not stimulating it, just alive. I think the prediction would be that those stoichiometries don't really change, right? We're not stimulating them, it's not moving to cell cycle state. Why would they? Okay, so what's keeping that alive? Well, phosphorylation is keeping it alive, for sure, right? Every single process pretty much is being kept alive by phosphorylation, but nothing's changing. So is it individual molecules within that, to take a molecule of interest, let's just say it's 50% phosphorylated, and it needs to be 50% phosphorylated, okay? So is that 50% of the molecule just floating around, 50% of them have got phosphate on, 50% have not got it on, and it's the ones with phosphorylation is doing the thing and keeping the cell alive? Or are individual molecules switching on and off, right? Millions of individual molecules within a cell in a fashion that's coordinated, maybe as the cell's processing information, it's binary switches switching on and off. But when we fix the situation, we lose all that information and we just get the stoichiometers. I would argue it's the latter. And I think that we're probably blind to all that kind of processing power without being able to measure. That's my interpretation. And hopefully we have the message to at least start to get at this. Okay, so I'm going to switch topic now. I'm going to try and keep the idea of simplicity, the complex problems, as the title suggests there. And talk about anti-cancer treatments. That's the other half of my lab very interested in how we can use our information that we learned from fundamental science to treat cancer better. And one complex problem in cancer research, I would say that something that's been along for as long as we've been researching cancer, being able to treat cancer with drugs, is this idea of, can we achieve tumor-selective cell cycle inhibition? Okay, so we know that most broad-spectrum anti-cancer drugs used in the clinic today stop cell cycle progression, often by causing DNA damage, so indirectly. Of course, that's very important in terms of the cancer treatment, stopping the cancer cell undergoing these rounds of division. But we all know as well that they're incredibly toxic because healthy cells need to undergo division, right? So can we just, and that toxicity, it's not just incredibly bad for patients in terms of their pretty horrible treatments, but it limits the amount of treatments that patients can tolerate, so that it limits the success of those treatments killing the cancer cell, essentially. So it's dose limited. So can we do better than that? Well, there's been billions invested in new cell cycle drugs, which are more specific because they do hit the cell cycle, don't do it indirectly like these drugs do. And so they're examples of kinases, microtubule motors, for example. We've got very specific drugs now for those that work very good in cells, work very good in animal models, but you put them into patients, perhaps too early to say for sure, but they've been pretty much disappointing because they offer no benefit over the others. So still as toxic, which you might assume that, well, healthy cells need these things as well, right? So this whole field would have been, I would say, a huge disappointment had it not been for these CDK4/6 inhibitors, which came on, you go back a decade, they came on the market less than 10 years ago, and they were fast-tracked approved by the FDA, really exciting. And so let me tell you a little bit about those. So they're used now to treat patients with the main estrogen receptor HER2 negative breast cancer, which is about 70% of breast cancer cases. It's used to treat metastatic disease in combination with what was previously gold standard estrogen receptor or anti-estrogen tablets, in this case, letrozole. So you can see that what these drugs did was they dramatically improve progression-free survival. And now in the latest trials that have come out, in some cases, for some of the inhibitors, increasing overall survival. So the first thing to point out about these inhibitors is that very well tolerated by patients, they're oral drugs. The patients don't need to typically be monitored in hospital whilst undergoing the chemotherapy. They go home, take these oral drugs, and they tolerate them reasonably well. And so I think this is very exciting from a cell cycle drug, which is well tolerated, that seems to hit a metastatic breast cancer. That clearly there's a lot of excitement for other tumor types there as well. So there's three drugs licensed for breast cancer. Just to put one in the picture, this is Pfizer's first-in-class Ibrance, or palbociclib. It makes more than any other oncology drugs put together, and that's just breast cancer. And they're being trialed in many other tumor types. There's at least 15 other inhibitors in the market, more than 100 trials. They're testing monotherapies, combination. It's a huge field in terms of translation. And I was kind of like naive to all this until about 4 or 5 years ago. I went to a meeting, the Cold Spring Harbor meeting, council meeting, and they were everywhere to talk about this. And one thing that hit me, it was this question: how do these drugs work? And I don't think there was an answer for that. Let me just like qualify that before everyone thinks it's quite strange. Because in some ways, we knew exactly how they work, right? They inhibit CDK4/6, firstly. And we know what CDK4/6 does. It binds to its cyclin, so cyclin D, and it phosphorylates RB. And RB would inhibit E2F, which is a key transcription factor. But when phosphorylated, that inhibition is relieved. And so you've got this transcription factor which drives S-phase, right? But all the genes needed for S-phase, or many of them. So the inhibitor would stop this happening, keep these cells in this inhibited state, and pause cells in G1. That was clear. What wasn't clear is, why does that pause in G1, why is it cytotoxic in many tumors and not cytostatic? That wasn't clear, right? So patients, often tumors shrink, patients come off the drugs, and then in many cases, you know, they don't experience relapse. And so the tumors are shrinking and dying, and they're not just paused when they come off the drug and they start dividing again. And this question wasn't clear. And so that was the thing that really intrigued me. And there's a lot of ideas, and, you know, that can range from extrinsic effects on the immune system to intrinsic effects on things like metabolism. But one key thing for me as a cell cycle researcher was this: why do cells seem to enter senescence after a certain amount of time in this drug? But it wasn't clear why. Senescence is obviously, for most of you, I'm sure we're familiar with, it's a response to stress. But what is the stress? Like, why are these cells becoming senescent? And there were some ideas, but it wasn't clear. And so when I came out for this meeting, there was a student, actually the project wasn't going very well. She was using this future reporter. Very far in the questions we were asking. So Lisa then picked up this, and we said, well, actually, I think one of the issues with senescence, and I still think this is a problem, is there's a reliance on fixed endpoints to measure senescence, and those fixed endpoints aren't great and can sometimes be misleading. And so what we said was, let's just use a future system where we can do live assays, and we can base our assumptions on that most cells, especially cancer cells, when they're in culture, they'll divide and divide and divide and divide. And if they stop for any length of time, are likely to have withdrawn from the cell cycle. And that was our kind of, let's just image these and look at it. And Lisa was joined with Reese after a year or so. And then for a couple of years later, they had this paper. And this is published earlier this year. I'm going to just make, I think, three slides to give you the background and then move on to the unpublished stuff. But what they showed was, I think, the first link between these drugs and genotoxic stress, as you can see their replication stress. Well, let me describe that to you. So this is the kind of Fucci assay. So each of these lines in this graph is a cell. And if it's red, it was in G1. And then as it goes into SS, they go yellow, green, and then to mitosis. And so you can see here, we've had the drug, CDK4/6 inhibitor, for a day. And then we wash out that drug and go down to the microscope and start the movie 6 hours after drug washout. We actually have to wash really extensively to make sure we've washed the drug out. And at that 6 hour time point, most of these cells are in S phase and they progress through S phase. And when these lines turn white, that means they've got into mitosis. So they go into mitosis about 16 hours later. It's a fairly normal cell cycle. And what happens when you hold them in the drug for 7 days, a very different picture. So now these cells have been held for 7 days. And when we release them, the first thing to know is they struggle to get out of G1. So these lines are red at the start compared to here. So they take much longer to get out of G1. And there's a portion of cells here at the bottom which never get out of G1. So that's the first thing to know. But then of the ones that do get into S phase, they have longer SG2 phases. And most of them never get into mitosis. They revert back to G1 again. So they're going through replication. This doesn't tell us that, but we've done that with other assays. They're going through replication, and then they're not getting into mitosis, reverting back. And the consequence of that, with a long-term proliferation, is that if you hold them in for 1 day, and you wash them out, and you plate 500 cells down, you'll essentially get 500 colonies back up, right? They can proliferate long-term. But if you hold them for any length of time, you won't. Actually, over 2 days seems to be a real trigger. Any longer than 2 days, you essentially don't have long-term proliferation because these cells have been drawn from the cell cycle. Okay, so what's going wrong? Well, we hooked up with Tony Lee and Dundee, who's really been kept with us with this project right from the start now. For everything else I'm going to say, and he's been a sort of mass spec expert. And what Tony sort of identified was we compared 2 days versus 7 days. We wanted to see the things that were different, causing these problems. What we saw was that a lot of replisome components, including MCM complexes, were downregulated during this long-term arrest. And then with the help of Gene Cook's lab, we showed that this MCM loading doesn't recover back to normal levels, and the cells go into replication with under-licensed origins. And that's one of the problems. I'll say one because there are much, much more, one of which is many of these replisome components are actually low, like PCNA, you know, the core replisome components are down, lower than they should be. So I think there's a lot of problems which I'll come on to in our latest work. But the result of that is that they have faulty replication. And our prediction was that they withdraw from the cell cycle from G2, as I showed you, they're going red here, due to P53 dependent pathway, because that's been shown to respond to replication stress and lead to cell cycle exit. And that was consistent with this data. We do P53 knockout, cells get through, but then they get into mitosis. They're not reverting anymore, and they're doing better long-term colony-wise. And so I think this is important because the biggest genomic study of resistance acquired and intrinsic in patients has identified P53 as the most prevalent driver of resistance. But that paper actually excluded P53 because it couldn't explain it. I think that this probably can explain why P53 is so important. The other thing that you point out from this graph is you'll see after 7 days of treatment, even if you haven't got P53 and you're getting into mitosis, you're not doing very well long-term, right? You don't just continue to proliferate. So these cells are struggling. Why? And that's really evident here. If we track those seven-day cells and we look at them, they get through mitosis and they've completely shattered the DNA. You can see it in the nuclear morphology there, but you can stain for gamma H2AX and they have high numbers of gamma H2AX foci. They have this fragmented nucleus and often micronuclei, fragmented nuclei. And so what happens here is that basically cells, what we think happens is that they've under-replicated DNA gets basically pulled during mitosis. At least one of the things that happens, it gets ripped in mitosis and you get shattering of chromosomes. So but just to summarize that paper in this slide, delaying G1, things that get downregulated, you have problems in replication and you withdraw from the cell cycle. Here you have P53. If you don't have P53, you'll undergo this mitosis. which is really error prone because you under-replicate your DNA and you get these kind of structures. Okay, so this link these drugs to DNA damage, which you know I think is important because most of our drugs that we have to treat cancer, you know, damage DNA, and so this is interesting. But the real question that we had a lot after this is what's happening during this G1 delay that's causing such big effects? And so Reese and Lisa carried on with this. They were joined by Anshel. So three really great students have been working on this together in my lab for the last couple of years. There's two papers we posted into BioArc. I'm going to talk about one more in detail and one just in a slide. I'll present the key points. It was kind of obvious what was happening to us because we were studying these cells and probably obvious to anyone else studying CDK4/6 inhibitors because it's kind of known in the literature. And that is cells just get bigger in size when you're resting in G1, right? So you're stopping the cell cycle in G1. And they just grow and grow and grow, so that by the end of 7 days, you've got these giant cells, okay? And you can measure that in measuring cell volume. You can look at protein content per cell. You can look at RNA content. The cell is getting bigger, but it's not undergoing replication, okay? And like I said, it's kind of known. It's consistent with work of other labs, actually, that I say here. The key question for us is, are these gross phenotypic changes the thing that are causing problems? So what we wanted to do is we wanted to prevent this growth and see how it rescued our phenotypes. So to do that, we took this big one cells in G1. We said, if you arrest them with CDK4/6, but as well as the CDK4/6, we turn off the mTOR pathway, we can shut off the growth. Okay, so that's shown nicely there in those three cell types. So now we have conditions where we've arrested them for the same length of time, the same CDK4/6 inhibitor for up to a week, but we've constrained the growth by mTOR or not. So we can ask the question of, is it the size difference here that gives us the phenotypes? And so when we release these from longer rest, how do they look when we show those phenotypes that I mentioned earlier? So here's the Fuji trace that we've shown before. I'm not sure it's the same one. It's a different experiment, but it essentially shows the same thing. And if we look at that, we get that these are the large cells that have been inhibited for 7 days of CDK4/6. If we contrain, we can quantify the numbers, by the way. These red are the ones that don't get out of G1, and these yellow ones are the ones that revert back from G2. So you can keep an eye on those. Essentially, if we constrain the size of the cells, we rescue those phenotypes incredibly well for them. Now, if we look at the DNA damage, these are in the P53 knockout cell, they go into mitosis, shatter the DNA right there. Is that because of the size? Well, if we do that experiment, either looking at either gamma H2AX or nuclear morphology, when we constrain the cells, essentially completely rescued the amount of DNA damage we see at the end of mitosis. And if we look at long-term proliferation, I think this is really the most important thing when we think about it. This is what I showed you before, a different experiment again, but you can see that after 2 days, here 4 and 7 days, these cells can't proliferate long term. They're large, they can't proliferate. If we've been inhibited for 7 days of the same CDK4/6, we constrain the size, absolutely fine after 7 days, essentially. So what this tells us is that mTOR status determines whether a cell responds to these drugs in a way that is either cytotoxic or cytostatic. Right, so I think that this is a really crucial point here, and end of the talk. It's the fact that cells are growing so big that they're having a problem afterwards. Okay, so mTOR is essential to drive toxic growth during the G1. That's the first point. Now, there's a couple of questions, one of which, why is this growth toxic? It's one thing you might be wondering. This is the focus of the work with Tony, who followed this on, and Alexis. It's a really great joint effort between our labs and theirs. Papers on BioArc. I'm going to summarize it in one slide. It's kind of interesting, but I want to focus on the other question. So it's toxic because it's up, the proteome scales abnormally, firstly. So the cell's growing bigger. So if you look at by proteomics of how the proteins scale in the cell, many of them scale with size. So this is the whole proteome gets about 4 to 5 times bigger, and the cell gets 4 to 5 times bigger. But if you look within an individual protein, some things superscale, such as lysosomes and endosomes, and some things subscale, such as nucleosomes you would expect because the nucleus, the DNA is not scaling, but things like nuclear localized proteins, things that bind to chromatin, also subscale. So there's a dilution of those factors. So the proteome is being skewed in big cells. That's the first thing to point out. Phenotypes that result from that, firstly, dilution of key nuclear proteins, we think leads to the replication stress problems. And the other thing, I haven't had time to go into, but it generates osmotic stress, which activates a P38 pathway, which induces P21. And this is, we think that this is the main problem that cells struggle to get out of G1. Remember those cells that stay red? They struggle to get out of G1 because P21 is driving cell cycle exit. I showed you that some of them do get out of G1. And in fact, they degrade that P21 and get out of G1. They have trouble, probably because of this. And I think other things, but I don't want to go into that. That activates a second wave of P21, causes cell cycle exit. So if you want to know any more about any of this, see that paper on bioarchive. What I wanted to focus on for the last 10 minutes is what are the implications for cancer treatment? This is what I started with. This is the thing that's really driving what we do in the lab. And I think that this is a really simple concept here. There's some very important things to point out. So mTOR, firstly, is driven by different upstream activities in healthy cells and cancer cells. Okay, so growth factors in healthy cells will drive mTOR, and oncogenes will drive in the cancer cell. And in healthy cells, those growth stimuli can be suppressed in certain situations, right? So they'll respond to growth suppressors, whereas cancer cells tend not to. So we wanted to see, could this lead to differential sensitivity of those two cell types? So the first thing was to look at growth repressors. So one of the most common things to think about, which is universally lost in cancer cells, is contact inhibition. You know, a healthy cell will contact its neighbors and it makes an epithelial monolayer will tend to stop division, whereas a cancer cell is, of course, done. That's universally lost. So we wanted to see, could that lead to differences? So these are the three cell lines, breast cancer or non-transformed RPEs, which contact inhibit very nicely. So as you would predict, if you grow these to confluence and inhibit CDK4/6, then mTOR activity is shut down in the non-cancer lines, but it's not in the cancer lines. And these continue to grow in size and the non-transformed don't. And so what happens when we look at phenotypes of these is kind of what you would predict. Right, it's what I showed you before with an mTOR inhibitor. Essentially, we rescue the phenotype very well and we improve long-term proliferation. So really what this says is that you can have conditions where you can put a CDK4/6 inhibitor, but a healthy cell would survive it very well because it contacts its neighbors and a cancer cell wouldn't. I think that's potentially important because it says that in our body, perhaps, you know, when patients maybe are undergoing this treatment, perhaps our healthy cells are protecting in some way because of this. Whereas cancer cells wouldn't be able to do that. You wouldn't predict they would be able to. So we can do other things and can reduce serum, for example. The prediction is that it will stop growth. That worked quite nicely. We can reduce serum to low serum. An RPE cell will start to turn off. This is an mTOR substrate, by the way. We turn off mTOR activity, shuts down growth quite nicely, not quite as nice as the contact, but these cancer lines don't touch mTOR activity or growth. And reduces serum, rescues phenotypes, not quite as well, but it seems to be always a very good correlation with a level of growth here. And so reduced growth factor signaling can protect healthy cells, but not cancer cells. And our prediction would be that oncogenes are the things here that are driving this growth in low serum, right, in cancer cells. So we can test that prediction. We think that in a breast cancer, the oncogenes are typically PI3 kinase, certainly in the two best cancer lines that we've been using. So we can inhibit downstream signaling of this PI3 kinase by using an AKT inhibitor. And if we do that, in this case, we can now shut down the breast cancer lines from growing toxically. And the RPEs, we don't really do much. So you can see that S6 tracks with the mTOR activity. These have high mTOR activity. It's an allosteric inhibitor, so it shuts off phospho-AKT very nicely in all three. Perhaps a better way to do this is to revert the oncogenic mutation. So we used oncogenic aversion line where that PI3 kinase was reverted back to wild type. And we can, restrain growth. We don't completely prevent it. And I won't show you all the data, but it's in the bioarchive that protects against DNA damage, long-term proliferation, sort of thing. So oncogenes, oncogenic pathways are driving toxicity in cancer cells when you inhibit CDK4/6. Right? So inhibiting those pathways, that we know that because inhibiting those pathways protects them. Okay, so the last data slide I'm going to show you is, I think, an important one. We should be able to go into non-transformed breast lines and put an oncogene in there, knock in an oncogenic mutation, and make them sensitive. And that's what we do here. So in an MCF10A, if we knock in PI3 kinase mutation, they get bigger, firstly, they get bigger. They induce more P21, this is the one at the end here. They have much more DNA damage, this oncogenic mutant, when they're rested for 7 days in CDK4/6 compared to a wild type house. And probably this is the most crucial result, when we look at long-term proliferation again. These can't tolerate long, you know, being held in that for longer than a few days again. 7 days, they won't grow back out. Whereas here, in a wild type situation, it's cytostatic, they don't care at 7 days, right? We've not got the oncogenic mutation. I think this is really an important result because it says that inducing oncogenic pathway can sensitize cell CDK4/6. So in summary, what I've shown you here, it's quite a simple idea. Oncogenes are driving growth and proliferation in tumor cells. And if you inhibit that proliferation, the DNA replication, the growth becomes toxic. And so if you can think of it another way, and we can say that inhibiting G1 transition with these inhibitors can turn an oncogene into a tumor suppressor. And I think what I mean by that is you can turn pathways that are pro-proliferative and turn them anti-proliferative, right? We can take pathways that cancer cells are addicted to and turn that into a liability. And I think that that's just really important when we think about that general question, which I started with, is can we achieve specificity with a general inhibitor? I think we can if you can inhibit this pathway, but it's going to be, how do we do it? What are the potential implications of treatment? I put it this way because I think it's nice to show here what you would predict you would want to do here. So oncogenes are driving these two things and they're intrinsically coupled because they have to be. I don't have time to go into that, but I'll happy to be questioned. These two processes have to be coupled to keep cell size and cell division coordinated. And what we do here by inhibiting this is uncoordinate the two. And so what would be a good therapy? Our prediction would be that you inhibit this really hard and you leave this untouched. Okay, that would be the prediction. And that is exactly what standard of care treatment in breast cancer does. I told you there's letrozole plus CDK4/6. So these ER positive breast cancer cells have estrogen driving transcription of cyclin D. And so if you inhibit that, you inhibit the cyclin D transcription and you inhibit this activity on top. That's a double hit to this pathway. Crucially, without the prediction at least, is that you don't touch this and you leave it and you allow it to be toxic. Now, in other situations, it might not be so easy to do that because when a cell is growing, it's producing the things either via translation of cyclin D or transcription of cyclin D. These oncogenes are producing more and more of this. If you do monotherapy in a cell line, it's actually quite difficult to hold it because they're producing the things. So you might need these kind of combinations to think about. But the field actually is thinking, I would say about, it's a natural thing. If we just think about this as inhibiting this activity, well, we can do that by inhibiting the oncogenes in CDK4/6. And currently 100 clinical trials are ongoing testing those combinations, oncogenic mutants with CDK4/6. And I think it's too difficult to predict what those combinations do, because in some cases, yes, it's going to be very good because it's going to lead to a very efficient arrest. What we also need to, I think, consider is that arrest going to be cytotoxic or cytostatic? And we'll see. And what we really need to do as a lab, for my lab, what I would like to do and what we're trying to do now is to take this stuff which we've done in cell lines and look at it in animal models and clinical samples, because that's absolutely crucial. You know, if it holds true in animal models and clinical samples that cells are growing bigger, then we certainly need to use that information to start thinking about what these best combinations will be. And that's work for the future. Okay, so I'll finish there. I think I've liked everybody, including funders that went along. CRUK first funded pretty much all the work I told you about today. And yeah, they're the people in my lab, the great lab team, great collaboration with Tony Alexis. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you. Jade, for a really great talk. Plenty of time for questions.
So the sort of specificity, you know, in this inhibition only in cancer cells is achieved because in a healthy cell where growth and division are also linked, if you stop division, you also stop growth. And then the cancer cells because of the
the prediction would be that the healthy cell doesn't grow quite as much when you stop the proliferation because it's not constantly driven by proliferative signals. But I think that, you know, that's, you know, and so some of this work, quite a bit of the work I showed was in an RPE cell, right? And when you bathe them in serum and we put them in the incubator, they're still growing. And so even if you don't have, RPE cells actually may have a KRAS mutation, so they're not completely wrong. Like you pointed out. But if you've got growth signals, perhaps they're still going to grow. But the oncogenes, I think, will drive that growth to the excess. And also, we should not forget, which I mentioned with the contact inhibition, that as cells grow, they're more likely to contact their neighbors at the side. And that contact in a healthy cell would be predicted to shut off the growth, whereas a cancer, it wouldn't. So I think that they're, in general, yes, they're more primed to grow. So cancer cells are primed to grow and proliferate. And if you inhibit the proliferation, well, the growth is going to be bigger. That's the simple explanation. No, I'm sure it's not. So what you mentioned there in apoptosis is one of the key, you know, when you say it's not as simple as that, that's one thing I would say for sure. Like what I've talked about here is the capacity of cells to overgrow and become senescent in the context of the body. And we don't actually see much apoptosis in these cells looking at a microscope, we've inched them from dense, right? So in the context of a body, that's clearly, you know, very likely to be different. And I think there's some good cases where senescence doesn't necessarily check with the response, whereas apoptosis does. So that's the first point. And you could argue that there's other routes to senescence, right, as well. So similarly, not just the growth driven, it's equally valid. In terms of scheduling, I think this is a really important one, right? I think that, you know, just thinking about the data that we generate in the lab, I would think about things like, you know, how quickly do cells grow? You know, we might be able to shed. So patients typically, at least on two of the inhibitors, have cycles of on-off treatment. The off treatment is because they can't tolerate it for on all the time. So hit them as hard as possible and then give them time to recover and hit them again. That's kind of sledgehammer approach that we do for most cancer drugs. Well, that might be able to be optimized, right? You know, so you could be able to have, if the off cycles are actually driving the replication and toxicity, then maybe you do this more frequently and things like that. Coming back to the mTOR question though, whether you could optimize that, I don't know. I think that, you know, based on just the stuff that I presented, our prediction would be, well, that for what we've seen in these cells, that if you arrest for a few days or a long time and you don't grow, we don't see much difference between those states. So maybe you can optimize them in terms of sequence or something, right? Yeah. Yeah. No, actually, so we've done this in rapamycin, not the stuff I showed you though. So the best inhibitor we've got actually, so I said mTOR inhibitor, it's actually a dual inhibitor of PI3 kinase and mTOR. It's a PF or 5, something or other compound. It's all the data in the paper. That we found the best actually. Rapamycin still has a little bit of growth. So why, I'm not sure.
I'm wondering about your
sort of
cell dilution model. You're picking out the MCMs, and I get the idea of the dilution of cytoplasmic factors, but the nucleus
is. Yeah, it's like, why isn't it just on there? Yeah.
Yeah, and also the MCM should be loaded from the start of G1, but then why?
I know. There's more to, you know, it's not just the dilution of MCMs, actually. So I think Gene Cook Lab is carrying on with this. But one thing that they've, I think they presented early on this, I'm fine to say, but is MCMs start being degraded. So that normally very stable MCMs, but when you arrest them for a certain time, they start to turn over. So there's These are the sort of questions I'm sure that Jean's lab are going to be really looking at. She might have answers to that. I don't know. I think there are a lot of interesting questions about that. Yeah, but we haven't looked at it.
Cell-sized breast
cells,
they're called but in your release from the CDK, of course, there's some variation. Some cells make it halfway through, some don't get out.
Yeah.
And we tried to back solve the cells besides that you release and actually look at the correlation that way.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting, the stochastic response is definitely an interesting thing to think about, right? So why do cells behave so differently? Is that because of some pre-state where maybe they were in a different stage when you added the drug? We haven't tried fact sorting them. It's an interesting idea. The difficulty would be, when to fact sort them. We could fact sort them after they've undergone replication, then they have problems as a result of the different sizes. But I guess what you're trying to ask is before you do the washout, quite uniform, but we could fact sort them, then release them differently, and then see if the bigger ones. Is that what you mean? Yeah, we haven't tried that. We could look at size. The area is quite a good measure of size, so we could do some correlation, which we haven't done, of whether nuclear area, which is proportional to size, seems to track with the ones that have the severe phenotypes and not. We haven't done this. I think Alexis maybe has looked into some aspects of this. So I'll tell you what, so that's when they start introducing P21. So, I skipped over this paper and just mentioned that, you get osmotic stress and P38 comes on. Alexis has done some very nice P21 reporter assays. And what she finds is that really around this 48-hour time point, that P21 jumps up. And if we inhibit P38, the reporters don't jump up. So that's where the time they start understanding this osmotic stress. But I think that these cells are likely to be under a lot of stresses. It's like a crisis. A giant cell, right? They upregulate lysosomes. We haven't looked at autophagy like specifically, but it wouldn't surprise me if they're trying to generate energy. It's a very energy consuming thing.
I was also, just in terms of why being so big is toxic, was wondering about crowding. Like, do you think the crowding of the cell changes as a function of its size, or do the other changes to the proteasome kind of compensate?
Yeah, absolutely. I think definitely, you would predict that crowding. So this brings me on to Gabriel Neuer, who was in the lab of Angelica Mon, who published a very nice paper in Cell a few years ago showing that. And in fact, they used this CDK4/6 inhibitor at the very end. A lot of it was done yeast, but up to the end. And they have this model of cytoplasmic dilution and macromolecular crowding. And so that really fits onto you. And there's a lot of data to support that. And I would just say as well that he's also put a paper on this bioarchive. We combined it together. And one of the phenotypes that he has identified is the DNA damage response is weakened in large cells. And that's quite an intuitive, simple prediction as well. You've got the DNA, which stays the same, and then a big cytoplasmic volume. And if the DNA is amplifying a signal, activating a signal that's got a spreading of the cytoplasm, like P53, that's maybe weaker. So he's shown in the figure, but there's a lot of mechanisms to understand there. But,
Other CDK4/6 substrates apart from they contribute to toxic growth?
Yes, there are. I think RB is the crucial one in terms of the G1 arrest, because if you, or at least RB dependency, because if you get rid of RB, the cells don't arrest, right? And so you don't, if you're an RB negative cell, you won't arrest with CDK4/6. But CDK4/6 have many other substrates. And there's been some links of that to growth as well, actually. And I must say, but some, I think if a particular paper in particular was used as abemaciclib as the drug for CDK4/6, which I think has a different profile both in patients and both where you measure kinases. And I'm not sure how much of that is off target, but this is a general statement. But in short answer to your question is there are other targets, but I don't think there are key ones in terms of cell cycle progression, but there might be other ones that are relevant.
So,
if
you make the cells
big, I don't think have we ever tried reversing them? We we stop them getting big. I don't think we've ever tried to reverse them.
Another question is for the first part of the talk. So if you use a kinase inhibitor to look at the dynamics, presumably in the case where you have a coupling with the phosphatase, it will just decay faster than the signal. But can you see anything more interesting?
Well, so you mentioned that. So one of the only, I mentioned this in the dynamic commentary that we wrote. One of the only studies I think that's looked at these dynamics has been doing exactly what you suggest there, which is if something's very dynamic on off, if you inhibit the kinase, because the phosphatase is normally keeping it off so much, it will switch off quickly. And the EGF, if you typically do a pulse of EGF on cells, you might get signaling at the receptor, which goes up and then decays down to about 6 hours later. When it's maximum after an hour, if you put an inhibitor of that EGF, the signal turns off within seconds. It's really rapid. That tells you that the sites and those receptors are probably, doesn't absolutely tell you, probably flashing on and off incredibly quickly. And so why? I mean, it's a lot of energy used if that's not important, right? So that some of the ideas there for, I think, proofreading is another one, actually, in T-cell receptors. Something similar happens in T-cell receptors. That could be a proofreading mechanism. But I think I'm so that wasn't the full question, though.
The question is, can you test some of the ideas
with that kind of, yeah, so yes, you can. And what we're trying to do is do the opposite, actually. We're trying to develop ways to inhibit phosphatases within seconds. So we can do it with drugs, and we're actually doing that. It's a kind of a crude experiment, but we want to engineer chemical genetic ways to turn off this phosphatase within seconds so that we can look at things rising. Because then we can look at the global picture of the phosphate. But in correlation, we could do the kinases as well and start to use that. Yeah.
So you mentioned that to look at the balance between kinases and phosphatases, we found that the number of these bond models.
It's a good. This is a good question, and truth, we do see variation between species, huge variations. It's one of the fastest evolving regions, actually. So you get some flies and also sharks as well. Sharks are scary, right? And they've got lots of them. and plants don't have any, right? So you between there, you range from some with one up to like 40 or maybe 30 or something. So there's huge variation. There's groups that have worked in to try and look at what is driving that evolution. And I don't think there's any clear answers. There's been some trying to look at whether there's correlation between centromere size, microtubule numbers. I don't think there is. It's not as simple to say it's all about that kinase phosphatase balance. That's the first thing to say, because in yeast, that those two motifs are not conserved. So I think that, in metazoa, they're all in metazoa, and they're conserved in metazoa, but in other species, the chromosome segregates that have male motifs, that have checkpoints, don't have those obvious motifs anyway. So it's not just as simple as that. Sure. Different male numbers. I don't know of disorders that have different male numbers, but there are disorders. Quite interested, actually. So mosaic variegated aneuploidy is this kind of, as the name suggests, it's kind of driven by, excess aneuploidies, and there can be very different routes to it, one of which is a decrease in the BUBR1 protein itself. And that leads to chromosome segregation errors and cancers in an early age, and typically, lots of cancers at an early age. So it's a quite kind of devastating disease. But one thought is that could be due to, you're not changing the melt numbers, but you're changing the BUBR1 protein, and you might have a similar effect. But I don't think there's any link directly to melt numbers.
Okay. I think that this is a where else is
attorneys ever looked at this sort of thing? I don't know. It wouldn't, when I mentioned about the stresses, I wouldn't surprise me, right? I don't know if Tony has actually looked at this, but it's an interesting one to maybe think about. Yeah, we do the type of proteomics we do is just looking at protein, and we'd have to do it again with that, you know. So the mitochondria is like scale with everything else, and I think to check this, I think they were a super scaler actually in terms of the looking at proteins. Anything they scale more, so they ramp up the energy production through mitochondria, which might lead to oxidative stress and everything else. Right, so. Yeah, so that's one of the biggest superscalar. I think there were, I mean, certainly lysosomes, but I think there was kind of an increase in lipid pathways. We looked at metabolomics. I think, you know, doing things like that would be able to get out as well. Sod 2, I thought you said salt. Yeah, and is it unregulated? I think there are a lot of. What we'd really like to do is the prediction to me is there's two predictions actually, I think are really kind of interesting. Once you've got a big cell, it's very likely to be vulnerable to secondary drugs. That's the first thing to point out. And so going in with other things that are being vulnerable to the lower cells, I think is a very interesting thing from a complex soluble point of view. And so we're trying to screen for these kind of things, screen and that sort of stuff. But the other thing to point out is that the cells that don't arrest, that grow bigger, that get through, because they essentially grow themselves through and they carry on dividing, they have DNA damage, but they're kind of not, they're still proliferating. I think that DNA damage is then also a liability, which could be then targeted for secondary drugs in the DNA repair. So I think this knowledge might give us a lot of new ideas for combination.